object-oriented programming than what I was taught when I first learned object-oriented programming. I was taught it was all about classes and inheriting and, like, different types of mammals and these complicated taxonomies and UML diagrams and, like, wow. But we're going to come back to this a little bit later, but I think that the actual, like, the better way of conceiving of this is the way that people like Alan Kay, one of the founding fathers of the program paradigm, talk about it when he talks about the early days of small talk and things like that. And this is based on this idea of hiding state in little chunks and sending messages back and forth. And so the visual metaphor or the model of a model that I think works for this paradigm comes from Alan Kay, who was a biology major, and he gives us a really nice biological metaphor of cells in a body as being kind of like an object-oriented program. The idea being that each object is kind of like a little cell, which has its own little state, like its organelles and its little mitochondria and, like, whatever else is in a cell. I don't remember biology.
andere Gehirn.
Rebate library, if you know where it was to, by the way. We signed that to a class property, and then again, I think we can just update to that. and storage, which is another entity we created. I don't have it on the slides, but hopefully you can imagine what it might look like. And that will just be something which will represent talking, that will deal with you, talking to whatever store you're using. So if you're using a database, that would contain PDO and some queries or whatever. And then the other dependency you can see on the second line of the constructor signature is another instance of access token repository. And the Eagle IDD will notice that access token repository in the constructor signature is the same type as in the implement statement at the top of the class. So what this means is we can ask the storage repository to get a token from the store, we can check whether it's valid or not, and if it's not valid, we can call that other repository instance we passed in as a fallback method. So in our case, we're saying check the database for a storage, check the database for a token, and if we don't have one, we can call the next decorator, which in our case will just be the API repository. Yeah. And in this case, after we've called it, we've got a token back, the storage dependency can then save the token in our database again, so the next time we hit it, it'll be there and valid, and then we can return it. An important point to note is that this instance of access token repository we pass in could be any implementation we like. So if we want to add additional decorators to our chain, we can do that. So here's what the usage of that code would look like. We have to instantiate a few different things, wire things together. So an example of solid meaning having to write a bit of code, but solid tends to put the burden on the calling code. This is an example of that, so we can assess all the dependencies. And then what I think is really nice and really simple is that the client code, okay, does have to deal with wiring together these dependencies, but then you can just call one method and it gets a token back. And it doesn't need to know anything about what's happening underneath that. It doesn't know that there's any decorator pattern involved there. It doesn't know that whether it's getting a token from storage or from the API. It doesn't care. It doesn't need to know. So if we wanted to add an additional decorator here, let's say if we wanted to log every time we were hitting the API to request an access token, we could add a new implementation of our repository and sandwich that in between the different layers of our decorator setup. The final pattern I want to briefly mention, I don't have time unfortunately to go into any detail on this, is the observer pattern. This is another way you can keep your classes open for extension. If we think back to that controller example, where we'd refactored out into a service class, we could make that class more open to extension by using the observer pattern. All I can say is this is a really interesting useful pattern. If you've ever used frameworks, event subsystems, they tend to use a version of the observer pattern, and there's some really great articles out there that you can go and read. I would recommend that. There's a good section in that book as well that I mentioned before. So we're on to the L of Solid, which is the Liskov substitution principle. Liskov substitution principle was formulated by a woman called Barbara Liskov. She was an awesome lady. She was the first woman in the US, I think that's right, to get a doctorate in computer science. And her principle states that objects in a program should be replaceable with instances of their subtypes without altering the correctness of that program. Or, if S is a subtype of T, then objects of type T in a program may be replaced with objects of type S without altering it.